Assalamu alaikum everyone. Welcome to another ATP video. Today we'll continue our series on gram-negative bacteria, and we will talk about three clinically important curved rods, which are Campylobacter jejuni, Vibrio cholera, and Helicobacter pylori. During this video, we will talk about the features of each organism, the clinical importance, and the treatment. As we start, we want you to know that all these three organisms have two things in common, in addition to being curved rods, and that is, they're oxidase positive and they're flagellated organisms. The first organism we'll talk about today is Campylobacter jejuni. So for the distinguishing features of this organism, note that we'll be mentioning the same exact statement three times in today's video, which is gram-negative, curved rod, oxidase positive with polar flagella. When you go camping, what do you do? I know you do many things, but for the sake of this video, let's agree that you light a campfire. Likewise, Campylobacter grows at relatively hot temperature at 42 Celsius. Now for the clinical importance, it's a common cause of bloody diarrhea, especially in pediatric age group. It can usually be transmitted by one of three ways: through person to person, through contaminated or undercooked food or unpasteurized milk, and finally by touching infected animals. It's also associated with Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is an autoimmune disease that affects peripheral nerves, mainly Schwann cells, and causes ascending paralysis. And finally, Campylobacter jejuni can cause reactive arthritis. For the treatment, we usually manage patients with supportive care. In other words, we replace fluids and we give electrolytes. However, antibiotics might be indicated if the patient is immunocompromised or symptoms are severe and not improving. In this case, we can use azithromycin or erythromycin. Remember, supportive therapy is usually the treatment unless indicated otherwise. The second guest in our video today is Vibrio cholera. Again, we will talk about important lab features, clinical importance, and treatment. For its characteristics, remember the common features between all three organisms? Yes, Vibrio cholera is a gram-negative, curved-rod, oxidase-positive with a flagella. In addition to that, it grows in alkaline media. For clinical significance, it's mainly transmitted by ingestion of contaminated water or uncooked food. It's sensitive to the high acidity in the stomach, and thus it requires high dose to be able to infect humans. It can cause profuse watery diarrhea, and it does that by secreting enterotoxin. How does enterotoxin work? The enterotoxin permanently activates GS, which increases adenylyl cyclase activation, consequently leading to continuous production of cyclic AMP. As a result of that, there will be increased chloride secretion and water will follow, thus leading to diarrhea. For the treatment, we use supportive therapy as well, and for that we use something called oral rehydration therapy, also known as ORT. Please note that there are other clinically important Vibrio species, such as Vibrio parahemolyticus, which can cause acute gastroenteritis with diarrhea. The diarrhea could be watery or bloody. And Vibrio vulnificus, which can cause septicemia, wound infection, or again, gastroenteritis. The third and last organism for today is Helicobacter pylori. Starting off with its features, the first statement that we say is Helicobacter pylori is a gram-negative, curved-rod, oxidase-positive with a flagella. It's also good to note that it's catalase-positive and urease-positive. This is sometimes referred to as a triple-positive organism because of oxidase, urease, and catalase. For clinical importance of Helicobacter pylori, it colonizes the antrum of the stomach, and it can cause peptic ulcer that is in the stomach and or the duodenum. And it's good to note that it's the most common cause of ulcer in each one separately, but the percentage is much higher in duodenal ulcers. It can also cause gastritis. Now here we'll go back to relate to the function of urease, which is the enzyme that allows H. pylori to be pathogenic. This enzyme breaks down urea in the presence of water to carbon dioxide and ammonia. The ammonia can neutralize the acidity of the stomach, allowing H. pylori to survive. Moreover, the same enzyme helps in the diagnosis of H. pylori, specifically an active infection, by a test known as urea breath test. Remember, urea is broken down to ammonia and carbon dioxide, So the test works by giving the patient a radioactive urea, in which the carbon atom is the radioactive component. Once they take it, if they have H. pylori in their stomach, it will be broken down to ammonia and radioactive carbon dioxide, and then eventually they will exhale the radioactive carbon dioxide, and we can detect that. Helicobacter pylori is also associated with increased risk of gastric adenocarcinoma and MALT lymphoma. MALT stands for mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. For the treatment of Helicobacter pylori, we have different combinations, but the most commonly used initial therapy is the triple therapy, which consists of amoxicillin or metronidazole if the patient is allergic to penicillin, plus clarithromycin, plus proton pump inhibitor, like omeprazole. Another treatment can be used is quadruple therapy, which includes tetracycline, bismuth, metronidazole, and PPI. Remember, these are not the only treatments that we use to treat H. pylori, and there are other combinations. Okay, now to summarize. We talked about three gram-negative curve draughts. The first two can cause diarrhea, Campylobacter usually bloody, while cholera is usually watery. The treatment of both is usually supportive. The last one is Helicobacter pylori. It commonly causes peptic ulcer disease, and for that, we use triple therapy. Finally, we hope you enjoyed this video. Let us know in the comments if you have any suggestions or feedback. Don't forget to like and subscribe to receive our latest explanations. And as always, thanks for watching. Goodbye.